So now after using the information that you learned from him, from Dr. Good, from your clinical experience, you know, what in your view is cancer?
Kelly, I'll give you a circuitous answer to that question, but Kelly's work was actually based on the work of John Beard, who was a very well-known scientist at the turn of the last century. He was a professor at the University of Edinburgh. He was English by birth, but taught at the University of Edinburgh in Scotland. And he was a PhD embryologist who initially wasn't interested in cancer at all, but in the esoteric things of embryology, like the development of sense organs of a parasitic worm and how they formed in the embryo. He eventually got interested in the placenta, which in mammals, of course, is the connection between the growing embryo and the mother's uterus, and that's how we as mammals survive initially as embryos. We get all the nutrients and oxygen we need from the mother's blood supply and get rid of our waste products into the blood supply of the mother. And the placenta is the connection between the growing embryo and the mother, and that's an anchor for the fetus, but as well, it's the connection, the life-supporting connection between the embryo and the mother's blood supply. Now, the embryo itself, when it first develops, it develops the trophoblast, which is the initial phase of the placenta, and it's a very invasive tissue. And Beard made the extraordinarily brilliant observation that its early appearance and behavior, this early placental tissue, is very much like a cancer. After all, the purpose of the placenta is to invade into the uterus, is kind of the way a cancer would invade into an organ. And it proliferates, grows very rapidly. It has a very rapid cell division, which Beard recognized. It invades through the underlying uterine tissues to anchor the embryo. And it also produces a very rapid blood supply. Of course, today we use the word angiogenesis, which is the ability of cancer and even normal tissues to produce a new blood supply rapidly. Beard didn't use the word angiogenesis. That's a modern term. But he realized that the placenta, the early trophoblast, which is the primitive placenta, produces a blood supply very rapidly. That's its whole purpose, to produce a blood supply that connects the growing embryo's blood supply to the mother's. Beard was a very expert histologist, and he knew about, even, you know, we're talking about 1900, he knew about cancer, and although we think of 1900 as kind of a primitive, long-ago time in science, by 1900, pathologists in the U.S. and in Europe had defined all the various types of cancer, and they knew what cancer looked like and how it behaved. They had already identified over 100 types of cancer. And they had determined that cancer had 5 distinguishing characteristics. Under the microscope, it was primitive, undifferentiated, divided without restraint, it was invasive, and migrated through the underlying tissues and produces a blood supply, what we would call angiogenesis. And Beard said, in its appearance and behavior, a cancer is exactly like the early trophoblastic / placental tissue. Primitive, undifferentiated, grows rapidly, invades, migrates, and produces a blood supply. But he went a step further to answer your question. He said it's not just the trophoblast, the early placenta, is not just a metaphor for cancer. It not only resembles cancer, it's a good analogy for cancer. He said actually cancer in its very origin is placental, is trophoblastic. And what he meant by that is during embryological development, he had discovered that as the trophoblast, the early placenta, forms, it invades into the uterus, that's true, but it also sends cells into the embryonic body, and as the embryo grows and matures into its final form, a lot of these early placental cells lay scattered throughout the embryonic body where they form nests. And normally those cells will sit there quietly for the duration of our lifespan, but he said under some abnormal signal, infection and inflammation, those nests of trophoblastic cells, a holdover from embryonic growth, these primitive placental cells that remain in all of us, he claimed and had the proof to show it, will start dividing as if they were going to form a placenta, but in the wrong place at the wrong time, you know, in the brain or in the lung or in the colon or in the pancreas, and produce a cancer. He said cancer doesn't develop from mature tissues that somehow go berserk and go backwards in time and come primitive and start growing rapidly, unlike normal tissues. He said they develop from these trophoblastic nests of cells that lie scattered throughout our body that through some abnormal signal start dividing. Now that may seem a little obscure and esoteric and going back 100 years, a long time ago. Modern researchers are changing their attitude toward cancer. We used to think, and I was taught in medical school, that cancer develops from the mature differentiated tissues, the line of the intestinal tract, the pancreatic cells, brain cells, that through some mutation or abnormality develop a whole new set of qualities, become primitive in their appearance, become proliferative, invasive, migratory, angiogenic. Beard said that's a lot of silliness. 100 years ago he said that. So they said that it doesn't come from the mature tissues, but from the trophoblastic cells. Well, modern researchers are beginning to say cancer doesn't come from these mature cells, just as Beard said, but from stem cells, which are these primitive, undifferentiated cells that lay scattered through all our body that actually serve a function, as you know, that every newspaper today is carrying stories on stem cells. These are these primitive undifferentiated cells that serve as a reservoir for tissues that are lost through normal turnover, through injury, disease, through death. And this is how cells and tissues regenerate normally. Wicke and his group at the University of Michigan and followers of him believe now that cancer develops when these stem cells start dividing abnormally and they don't have the normal restraint. And this is where cancer comes from. And basically what they're saying actually is cancer comes from stem cells, and what Beer discovered 100 years ago in these scattered trophoblastic cells are stem cells. Beer discovered stem cells 100 years ago, though he never got credit for that. So we believe, as do a lot of contemporary molecular biologists, that cancer develops from stem cells, as Beard called these early trophoblastic cells, that lose their normal inhibition and start dividing rapidly. I mean, normally they serve a healing function. They serve as a reservoir of replacement cells to replace tissues and cells lost through normal turnover, again, or injury or death or sickness. But when they lose their normal inhibition and restraint, they become tumors and can spread and invade and kill. So we believe cancer comes from these nests of scattered cells, what we contemporary scientists would call stem cells, what Beard called these germ cells he's the word germ cells for these trophoblastic cells scattered throughout the body. And that's how it forms. Now, why would cancer form? Why do these stem cells or trophoblastic cells, as Beard called them, lose their normal the normal restraints on abnormal growth? Well, Beard would say it's because we don't produce enough pancreatic enzymes. Beard thought the key to cancer was in pancreatic enzymes, that's the whole essence of our therapy. During his embryological research, he realized that there was a remarkable transformation in the trophoblast. Initially, it's very much like a cancer. It's primitive, undifferentiated, proliferates without restraint, and invades and migrates through tissues and produces a blood supply and grows rapidly, just like a cancer does. But at some predetermined point, suddenly the trophoblast / placenta changes its characteristics and becomes the mature, life-sustaining placenta, which stops growing, stops invading, and really is very stable. And he spent years of his life trying to figure out what the signal was for that remarkable transformation from the early invasive placenta, which was like a tumor, to the mature, life-sustaining placenta that doesn't grow and doesn't invade. And he realized the very day the placenta changed its character, changed its behavior, was the very day the embryonic pancreas began spewing out pancreatic enzymes. And he searched for any other clue that might explain that transformation. The only thing that happened in terms of time was the very day the trophoblast changed its character and stopped invading, stopped migrating, was the day that the embryonic pancreas began producing its pancreatic enzymes. And he then decided that it was the pancreatic enzymes that determined trophoblastic behavior and its destiny. And since these enzymes seem to control the abnormal growth of the trophoblast or control its growth, that these enzymes would also control cancer, since cancer is trophoblastic. And in animal studies and in human cases in 1905, 1906, he proved his point and had both success in animal studies and with human patients that were published in the mainstream medical literature but lost to posterity because no one took Beard seriously 100 years ago. So that's the story of where cancer comes from. It comes from these primitive cells that lie in all of us, what we call today stem cells, that through some abnormal signal start dividing uncontrollably and produce tumors that can invade and migrate and produce a new blood supply. And it's just a kind of a perversion of their normal destiny, which is to provide replacement tissues. Or what Beard would say also, that these are trophoblasts that are trying to produce the placenta, but in the wrong place at the wrong time, both in men and women.
So if the embryo produces the pancreatic enzyme.
Right, it's the embryo that does it, yeah. Beard said it was the embryo. Of course, the mother's producing pancreatic enzymes too, but they don't seem to get through the placental barrier. So the thing that ultimately that controls the growing trophoblast placenta and changes its characteristics would be the embryonic supply of pancreatic enzymes. And modern researchers have found that, indeed, the very day the placenta does start changing its behavior and its characteristics is the very day the embryonic pancreas begins producing enzymes. So they haven't made the connection, and certainly have made the connection between the trophoblast and cancer control through use of enzymes.